Okay. Hey, there we go. There we go. You guys can scoot up a little bit if you don't mind. Plenty of room. Excellent. You know what, Kelvin? I may have you go back and look at that through the that camera back there. Because I moved. I was just thinking. Ben texted me. He said he's going to be running about 10 minutes late. And so he is starting everything via, hopefully Elizabeth is driving, but he's starting it on the phone. So he can start Facebook, but he cannot adjust that camera. So I think you have to tilt it or something to get it down to where it, do whatever you got to do there. Then if Ben asks you about it, I'll tell him, Kelvin just went back and did that. So. Very good. Good evening, everybody. Good to have you guys. We had a good Bible study last night with a number of guys coming out. Appreciate that at 7 o'clock. And had a good day today, and I pray that we can have a little prayer time tonight as well. Got a few things that I want to discuss with you, if you don't mind. I wanted to begin tonight with just a little update from the Hilliards, a wonderful young missionary family down on the Amazon in between Portugal and Brazil. So they down on the Amazon River. And they write, "We apologize for the delay in this update. However, we wanted to include information about the medical trip that just concluded August 2nd. As many of you may remember, the BIMI generally has a medical team that comes to the Amazon twice a year, but due to COVID and restrictions that and of travel, there's only been one team that was able to come, but praise the Lord, they made it here. God was good during the short time that they were able to be with us. Generally, we see over 1,000 people in this medical mission thing and within the communities, but due to the multiple restrictions, we hold clinics in only 2 locations. The evangelism team, on the other hand, was able to go to many of the other towns as well. The clinical team was able to minister to over 400 people, praise the Lord, while the evangelism team presented the gospel all over the communities. We are incredibly grateful that despite the limited access, we still have the opportunity to get the gospel to many people that we would otherwise not have had the chance to reach. The spiritual warfare that we experienced during this trip was very evident. There were so many obstacles, yet we serve a great God who allowed us to complete the trip and finish well. The kids are continuing to grow quickly, not just in their stature, but also in their language skills. And that's the way it is with missionary kids. They learn the language before the actual parents do. And so he writes, Gabriel and Adeline love going to small local Christian school here where they have been learning Portuguese and have now started gaining the confidence to talk to people. Caleb has also been expanding, and it's also nice to see when toddlers can relay to you what they're crying about. That's true. On the ministry side, Nick has been continuing a series from creation to Christ with both of the churches that he's in charge of, while the main pastor missionary is on furlough in the States. Shaney is still helping with the children on the midweek service nights. Both speaking opportunities have helped improve our language skills. We are excited that another church has informed us of their support and partnership as we reach the Amazon region for Christ. God has always supplied our needs and exceeded our expectations, and we're both excited and humbled to see the greatness and goodness of God. So I hope that you feel it's sort of a neat thing to know that we support a young family that's down on the Amazon, propagating the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they are one sharp couple. They really are. And immediately upon meeting them, I could just tell they were really a wonderful couple and would make great missionaries. So they are down there and learning language quickly and acclimating quickly. This is when he was a teenager, he was actually in Steve Reese's teen group. And so, Steve Reese had a a fondness for him right away as well, as he knew him from many years ago. So this is the Hilliards, and we will be praying for them tonight as our missionary for the evening, and pray for God's blessings on them. All right. I think my wife is up there. If you got a song sheet, let's all stand if you would, and we'll get started this evening. Oh, it is wonderful to be a Christian. John W. Peterson wrote this. Amen. Life has purpose. Life has purpose now it never had before. There is meaning to each day and even more. For a joy and peace I can't explain is mine. Since I found new life in Christ my Lord divine. Oh, it is wonderful to be a Christian. Oh, it is wonderful to be God's child. Oh, it is wonderful to have your sins forgiven. Oh, it is wonderful to be redeemed, justified, forever reconciled. Now, for those of you who read music, I know there are some times in this song I go up and then I look and I should have gone down, but just run with it. I mean, you do the right thing, but if you want to go with me, it doesn't matter. It's going to be fine, and I will try to look a little more carefully. But second verse, I can go directly to the Lord in prayer. Praise the Lord. I can go directly to the Lord in prayer. He has told me I may boldly enter there. He listens as I promises I plead. I find mercy there and grace for every need. Oh, it is wonderful to be a Christian. Oh, it is wonderful to be God's child. Oh, it is wonderful to have your sins forgiven. Oh, it is wonderful to be redeemed, justified, forever reconciled. And the hope of heaven's glories thrills me so. Where I'll live with Christ forevermore, I know. That is why the things of earth I loosely hold. I've eternal riches better far than gold. Oh, it is wonderful to be a Christian. Oh, it is wonderful to be God's child. Oh, it is wonderful to have your sins forgiven. Oh, it is wonderful to be redeemed, justified, forever reconciled. Now, Shanna, I know you play piano. Am I supposed to go up or down on that bottom of where, oh, it is wonderful to have your sins forgiven. It's forgiven. It is? Man, I think I've been going up for years. I don't know. So now it sounds weird to go down. Anyway, well, you sing it any way you want, and I'll do the same. All right? Very good. Hey, let's have a word of prayer. Let's pray for Tori. She's going on a big trip in a couple days, right? Maybe? Is it canceled? It is. Okay. Well, that happens. Sometimes that happens. You know, sometimes my wife and I were ready for a big trip. We got all the way to Kearney. And then April started throwing up all over the back of the car. And then the other one wasn't feeling good. So we just said, you know what? We're only in Kearney, Missouri. Let's turn around. So we turned her around. So sometimes that happens. But anyway, I hope that you're able to reschedule that sometime. Let's pray tonight. Father, thank you, Lord, for the evening. We appreciate your goodness to us. And we thank you, Lord, for guiding us in our life. And we thank you for life. And thank you that we have a God that we can depend on. And I pray, Lord, tonight that our hearts would just be in tune with yours and realize that you know what's best for us. Help us through this life. And we'll thank you for that. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask these simple things. Amen. You may be seated. I do pray the Lord blesses us as we have a little Bible study tonight and then a little prayer time afterward. We have a number of things to pray for. You know, I'm really praying for Penny Anderson as well. She sits right here with her sister. And, you know, when she had that sonogram on the tumor, the sonogram lady, you know, a lot of times sonogram ladies, they don't say anything. They wait for the doctor. And so the sonogram, but she said, you know, it hasn't shrunk very much. And so that kind of concerned her a little bit. And She went back to the doctor this week, and they found another lump, which is odd while you're having chemo to have that kind of thing. And so, you know, I was just kind of talking to her, and we were sort of processing this information out. It could be a blessing because, I mean, most of the time when you're in cancer treatment, they have one chemo, a recipe, if you will, that, and if it's not effective, then it's, they need to go to plan B. And they always have the second, you know, recipe that they go to, and then the third, and that kind of thing. And so I said, you know, maybe it's a good thing to, if it's not being effective, to go ahead and go to the next one, which I'm not a doctor, if you needed to know that. But I am praying that God would help her. But she has great faith, and she's keeping her eyes on the Lord, and I appreciate her. And I don't know what it feels like to wake up with this knowledge every day of having this, but I think that God has just given her wonderful grace, and yet it's a scary thing to go through. And you know what she needs? She needs brothers and sisters in Christ who are willing to pray for her. So please pray for Penny. Pray for Katie down in Florida. She's watching her baby daughter get ready for surgery, but she's doing cancer treatment as well. And I pray for my mother-in-law as well, and there's good news on that. What'd you say? There was a cancer number. There was a indicator that things are going in the right direction.
I think her cancer cells were at or above 3,000 when she started, and they tested yesterday, and she's at 50.
At 50, from 3,000 down to 50. So obviously, it's really going in the right direction. So we rejoice in that, and I'm so thankful for that. So, but we want healing for all of those going through it, and pray for God's mercy to be upon them. And I pray for God's mercy on people. And I read that, David wrote that in one of the Psalms, and I thought, you know, I'm going to add that to my prayer life too, is that God would have mercy on them, you know. So please be in prayer for them. We'd appreciate it. We got some other things to pray for tonight, but we'll save that for a little bit later. Turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 12. Turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 12. Anybody have a praise item as God blessed you in any way that you want to, as we're turning over there and everything? I like hearing people give praise to God and thanksgiving, appreciation. Anybody have anything that you're praising the Lord about? Saying, I praise the Lord for a lot of things. But anyway, I praise the Lord that Wes is back with us. Good to see his face over there. And Luke is back in town too, I think. So I'm glad to see him. He's going to college and doing some other things. So anyway, yes, Holly.
This is so generic, but I'm just very thankful
for my friends. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, God bless you for that. I appreciate that. Wonderful. Amen. That's good. We're all thankful for our salvation as well, too, you know. What about you? Anybody else? Anything good happened to you? Very good. Okay, yeah, go ahead. Okay, how old are you? He's 20 years old, and they have just purchased their first home. Isn't that something? You guys remember your first home? I was ecstatic when I got my first. Matter of fact, I didn't even believe that we would get our first home. But praise the Lord for that. God has sort of worked things out for them to be able to own their own home and be able to move in. The only problem is he's in Ottawa. Well, that's not a problem, really. But actually, you're from kind of Ottawa, aren't you? So it's not a problem at all. Sorry about that. It's just a little bit of a drive, but it's not. It's on the north side. What's that?
I said, do we need to change churches?
No, not at all. That's not very far at all. That's right. Very good. Well, anyway, God bless you for that. I appreciate you being able to do that. And I love seeing that the Lord bless young couples like that, too. So my first home was $36,000, and I thought there was no way I could ever buy that home. And but God, my wife's faith and her prayers, she saw the house, and I didn't even go. I said, I'm not even going. I know we can't buy that house. And I didn't know how much it was, but I just looked on the outside and I said, I'm not even going to go. And but she's been praying, and that's when I learned that my wife was a prayer warrior, and God honors her prayers, and so I believe in prayer more now than I did then, that's for sure. So, but anyway, I'm happy for you. All right, Luke chapter 12 tonight. We've kind of been working our way through Luke 12. Luke 12 is a long chapter. I mean, what is it, 59 verses, something like that? It's a long one, but there's a lot of good information in it, and I think that it's tremendous. So I pray that the Lord blesses us as we go through that. I've been helping this family out, and I'm not, you know, they're not from here or anything, and I know no one knows them, but during the week, sometimes we get a hold of people get a hold of us, actually, about a need here or there. And so we have this one family that lives at the lake quite a bit, and it's just they live the hardest life you could possibly ever imagine. And sometimes they get temporary shelter someplace, and I'm happy for them, and we work with them and try to get some food in there for the baby and try to help them out a little bit and try to encourage them. And then usually it's a month or two later and something's happened, and next thing I know they're living back out at the lake again and that kind of thing. And this last week they somehow they gathered enough funds to be able to purchase a double-wide trailer in Ottawa, by the way. And so I thought, man, that's great, wonderful. I was rejoicing with them. And then whoever moved the trailer messed it up, and it kind of got twisted, and stuff got knocked down. So, you know, it's a real problem, not livable for them. So they're back out at the lake. And so it's up and down, up and down. And, you know, my conversation with them is that there's a better way to live, you know. There's a better way to live. Find the right way to live and try to introduce Christ. And so they're open to this, and I enjoy talking to them about that. And I would pretty much consider them friends. When I see them at Dollar General or wherever I go, they're big smiles, and, you know, they're telling me what the latest is on the saga of their life and how they're getting through it and all that kind of stuff. And our church helps them occasionally for a night at a motel to kind of get cleaned up and that kind of thing. And I try to, help them in every way that I can. But part of my talk to them is about spiritual things, and try to talk to them about the fact that there's a way to live your life that is better, and try to find the way that is a better way to live your life. And so if I could take that and look at Luke 12, I think Jesus was trying to teach people there's a better way to live your life. And we won't go back on all of it, but, you know, I will remind you of that verse 13, you know, where that man came and he was just like, oh, Lord, I'm having big problems. Jesus, would you help me out with this? My brother took all the inheritance, and I want you to go. Would you go and tell him to give me my fair share and all that kind of stuff? And Jesus just looked at him and said, hey, I'm not in the business of doing that. That's not what I do. I can see that you're filled with anxiety and covetousness, if you look at the verses surrounding that. But he said, you know, I'm wanting to do that. And then Jesus goes on to tell him that don't live your life that way. There's a better way to live your life than being worried about this person ripped me off or that person ripped me off. Guess what? In life, people are going to probably rip you off before you get. You're not going to be able to get through this life without somebody shortchanging you or charging you more than what you should be charged or not paying a bill that they should have paid. And you can go through the rest of your life with a big chip on your shoulder and being worried about those kind of things. But I think the principle is, even if you were the one being done wrong to, there comes a moment where you got to let it go. Just let it go. And take it. And there's a lot of passages about that. You know, in Corinthians, Paul talks about that, you know, the church being a litigious church, that taking one brother to court against another brother and all of that kind of stuff. And he says, hey, listen, why don't you just let it go rather than go out to the world and let them see our dirty laundry and how that we can't get along with each other. He says, better yet, as a church, why doesn't a leader stand up and be able to wade through these problems that you have with one another and solve the issue in-house as opposed to going out into the world, these ungodly judges solving problems that we have. Why go to court? Why not just, godly people standing up and doing these things? So life is more than worrying about people ripping you off. Number two, we've learned that life is more than worshiping money. He goes on right after that. He says, let's talk about the opposite problem. Not somebody ripping me off of a lot of money, but what about the guy that has all the money in the world? So much so that if the harvest goes just right this year, and if I can get my barns built that need to be built, then what I'm going to be able to do is I'm going to sit back, I'm going to be able to eat and drink and be merry and be filled with pleasure, as if that's the goal of the whole life. And Jesus says there's a better way to live than that. Why? Because thou fool. Because tonight your soul's, you're going to die. And then you're going to stand before God. You were rich in terms of men's account, for sure. But you were poor when it comes to your spiritual life. And tonight you're meeting your master. Tonight you're meeting your creator. And then what do you got? You're poor in that way. He said, thou fool, there's a better way to live than to worship money and to work day and night all the time saving that money. And this applies to retirement. There's some guys, all they think about is retirement, as if that's the entire goal for life. Nothing wrong with having a retirement plan, but you better have a retirement plan spiritually. Amen? That's a good place for an amen. A spiritual inheritance or retirement plan, where you're able to meet the master and he's able to look at you and say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. You've actually done the things that I want you to. So there's a better way to live than to make money your God and to worship that and to get yourself all set and get your T's crossed and your I's dotted and everything is in line for you to be able to eat, drink, and be merry. And he said, that's not really what life is all about. The life is more than that. Number three, life is more than worrying about your needs. He goes on to go back to the idea of, well, who's going to feed me? Who's going to clothe me? Where am I going to live? And all of those kind of things. And he said, life is more than, well, let's read it. Verse 22. Therefore, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat, neither for your body, what you shall put on. What does he say there? What is it, verse 21 or something? He says, life is more than meat, and it's more than raiment. Oh, that's verse 23, actually. The life is more than meat, and the body is more than raiment. Life is more than even basic, legitimate needs in your life than you worrying about that. And so we find that there is, I suppose if I had a point one, it would be there's a better way. Life is more than, there's a better way than that. So number two, let's just get into what is the better way to live your life if we're to take the advice and philosophy of Jesus. He says in verse number 23, and we'll start there, it says that life is more than meat and the body's more than raiment. Then he says, consider the ravens. Who, and we know the passage, right? I know you know it. And so who takes care of ravens? Who feeds ravens? Well, God does. Ravens don't even worry about what they're going to eat because they know that God has put them in a location that has food and they are going to be taken care of. So Jesus said, this is the better way to live. So what is the better way? To realize that life is about God becoming your provider. Now, I would like to, you know, what some guys say, drill down on this. You know, I would like to really focus on this for your life and mine. And I'm talking about the little things to the big things. Get to the place where you get in that lane where God is your provider. You know, we're supposed to be doing that. This is what giving thanks for a meal is all about. That's what it's all about. We sit down and we say, thank you, Lord, for our food. Bless us to the nourishment of our body, etc. Listen, what we're trying to instill in ourselves as well as our children in so doing, we lose the meaning of this. It becomes a tradition and something we do just because we do it. We forget why we're doing it. We do it because we want to get into the lane where God is the one who put this meat and potatoes or meat and greens on your plate. We get to the point where God's the one. I start my car. Thank you, Lord, for this car. I come home tonight and I get in bed. I pull up to my house. God's the one who provided that house. Listen, it's a mental thing that is spiritual. And you've got to get to the point where God's the one who does it. Just like the raven is taken care of by the Lord, we need to get to the point where God's the one who brought the harvest this year. The hay that you got in your barn, Randy, is only there because God provided those things. He's the one who let it rain, and you know the process better than I do. And he's the one who put the sunshine on it at the right time. Not too much rain, not too much sunshine, but just perfect temperature so that it would grow so that you could have hay in your barn. And so life is about God becoming our provider. And he uses the ravens, and he says to us at the end of verse 24, how much more are ye better than the fowls? If he takes care of the fowls, he's the one who provides for you. In verse 28, you skip down a little bit, and of course he gives the other thing in terms of clothing. He says, if God clothes the grass of the field, he'll clothe you. So your most mundane, basic needs, he is the provider. And we got to get that straight in our head. And that's what life is about. Life is about making this switch where everyone else, they think they're the ones who work hard and they pay their bills and they do all those things. And we have what we have. We got a boat. We got the camper. We got this and that and a vacation and all that kind of stuff because we work hard for it. You ask 99% of the people that are out there and that's what they're going to say. Not so with the people that are close to the Lord. It's the opposite. I have these things because God has provided for them. Did it take hard work? Probably it did. But guess who gave me the health to do the hard work? Guess who's the one who gave me the knowledge? Guess who gave me the job that provided for that? God did. So we have to continually drill down and focus in our mind that God is the provider. You do that and you are doing exactly what God wants you to do, where he is the provider. That's the place he wants to be in your life. That's a better way to live your life, rather than having some pride about, look at all the things that I've got. You never have the bumper sticker that says, he who dies with the most toys wins, because that guy is the guy who thinks that I'm so smart, I work the market, I do all this kind of stuff, and because of that, I've made some good choices in my life, and I've done all of that. That doesn't apply to us at all. That's a foreign concept to us. And so, for us, we think a better way of life is about God becoming our provider in big and little things. Number two, a better way to live is life is about God giving us the ultimate gift. So this is a focus for us. And he said, this is a good way for you to live your life. With high anticipation every day for when we get the greatest gift of all. And I suppose the greatest gift that God's given to us is salvation, but salvation is only there to give us the greatest gift, right? Salvation really is not the greatest gift, technically. Salvation is the ticket that gets us to the greatest gift. The greatest gift is heaven. The greatest gift is being in the presence of God forever and ever, eternal life. That's the ultimate gift. And God is looking forward to this day where he gives to you that eternal gift. You may be looking forward to it, but you are secondary to him looking forward to it. He looks forward to giving it out more than you look forward to getting it. And so, life is about giving us the ultimate gift and constantly thinking about that. The Bible says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God, verse 31, and all these things shall be added unto you. The other things are just, they come in addition to this. But seek first the kingdom of God. Matthew 6 talks about this as well. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these things, the mundane things, the little things, will be added unto you. Verse 32 goes on to say, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure. I love that, and I underline that. For it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. And I understand there might be some debate as to what exactly the kingdom is. And I think I mentioned that last week a little bit. And there is a little bit of debate about that. But the ultimate kingdom, of course, that he's wanting to give to us is the kingdom of God in terms of heaven. And he wants to certainly give that to us. And so that's the kind of thing that we should be focused on. That's the thing that gives us joy, because we have heaven looking to look forward to. So life is more than some things, but life is all about God giving us the ultimate gift in life. Number three, life is about becoming a provider for others. Now, we understand that we're to get in that lane where he is my provider. He is my provider. He's given me this. Praise the Lord for this, this, and this. But life is about that once you get into that lane and he does bless you, and he has blessed you, is then you looking at opportunities for you to be a blessing to others. Now, read with me, if you will, in verse 33. Life is about becoming a provider yourself for others. Sell that you have, give alms, provide yourself bags, which wax not old, a treasure in heaven that faileth not, where no thief approacheth, neither moth corrupteth. You see, when we begin to provide for others, then God will look upon that and he will bless you because of that. And so there are great blessings in store for those who become a provider for others. So as you look in your life and God's blessed you over and over again, why not for you to have life is about a better way to live your life is to be a giver and a provider yourself and to help people with, you know, needs that they have, or if their kids need something, or if somebody that's going down the street that maybe you see some, or a friend is going through a difficult time and you can be an encouragement in some way, why don't you become a provider for others as well? You see, now listen, this is the way God works. And I can say that with all confidence. This is the pattern. You see, don't go through life without getting this principle, is that God doesn't ask us to do anything that he's not willing to do. We understand that. He's the greatest boss of all time. We think of a good boss as being somebody who knows what it means to work as well, right? And so God doesn't ask us to do anything that he's not willing to do. We've already talked about he's our provider, and so he wants us to be a provider for others. Now listen, it goes on with other things that God gives to us, and many of you are familiar with this. But this is a big point. If God is a great forgiver, and God wants, as soon as you reap the harvest and the beauty of being forgiven by him of your sins, God wants you, when people offend you or do wrong to you, he wants the words, I forgive you, given to others as well. See, Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 says, for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. By the way, if you're not going to be a forgiver, don't even ask God for forgiveness, because he says it's closed because you're not willing to forgive others. I'm not going to forgive you. And so a better way to live your life is certainly to be forgiven, ask God for forgiveness, but then in turn become a forgiver for others. A great way for you to live is for you to understand that he's the provider, but then go ahead and become a provider for others as well. What are you doing? You're becoming like the God that you're serving, you see. And so Matthew says, if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. But forgiving people is hard. I understand that. But God's not asking you to do something he's not willing to do for you and has done for you way more than he's ever going to ask you to do for others. So be a provider, you know, get provision from the Lord, but be a provider, get forgiveness from the Lord, but be willing to forgive. Suffer for the Lord. 1 Peter 4:1 comes to mind. We need to be willing to suffer for the Lord. Hey, he suffered for us, right? Romans 12, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. You see, and, you know, it's our reason, as another passage says, it's our reasonable service to suffer for the Lord and to give back to the Lord. But 1 Peter is the good one, though. It says, for as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, it says, arm yourself likewise with the same mind. Have that same understanding. I'm willing to suffer for Christ. And if that means that because of my faith, somebody persecutes me or doesn't like me or gives me what for or whatever, then that's okay. I'm going to suffer for Christ, whatever that means. We don't have to, in America, we don't have to suffer for Christ too much. That doesn't come into play very often. But he says this, hey, if Christ is willing to suffer for you, you need to arm yourself with the same mind, to have the mind of being willing to be to suffer for the Lord. And so that's the way it is. If God wants to give help to us, we need to be willing to give help to others. Another passage that comes to mind, I'm just giving you a few, is the idea. Remember that moment in the upper room where Jesus was getting ready to have the Last Supper with them? And prior to doing so, what did he do? He got a pot out, right? Wasn't this the when he got the pot out, filled it with water, and he went around and he did what? He began washing other people's feet and serving them. This was the illustration that he's given. He said, I'm the master, and I'm willing to serve you. He said, I want you to be the same when you serve others as well, to get in this lane. And so this is the idea. John 13, 14 says, if I then, your Lord and your master, have washed your feet, ye ought also to wash one another's feet. And the illustration there is to have a servant's mind of taking care of each other. And so life is about becoming a blessing for others as well. And then number four. So we've gone through three. The good parts about life is about God becoming our provider. We get that in our head, and we thank him for everything we see, including our toast in the morning and eggs. Number two, life is about God giving us the ultimate gift, and that's on the forefront of our mind, is that one day heaven is going to be ours. He's gone to prepare a place for us, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will doubtless come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be as well. That you may be also. And so we think of that ultimate gift that he's going to give to us. And that's what life is all about, getting to that point, and it gives us joy. Number three, life is about becoming a provider for others. Life is about having a servant's mind, and that becoming a provider for others is included in that. But number four is life is about being ready for God's return. Join me in verse 36. And Jesus is teaching this lesson, and he's saying, and ye yourselves like unto men that wait for their Lord when he will return from the wedding, when he cometh and knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. Now, you can read into that a lot, right? And I think of certain moments in my life when I think of that. I think the word immediately means is that you're not having to go, that, you know, the Lord's knocking and saying, I'm ready to come for you. And then we have to confess sins. We've got to clean our house. We got to get rid of some of the stuff that we wouldn't want God to see and all of that kind of stuff. And but instead, he knocks and we can just open immediately and say we're ready. So let's get back into our theme here is life is more than some of the bad things, but life is all about the better way to live your life is to live a life that's ready for God's return. So in other words, you don't got to clean anything up. You are ready so that when he knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. No delay, no scurrying around, around and throwing things out, etc. Reminds me, when I was in college, I was a teenager and I was in college, and an older person that I knew that was married and had kids and all that kind of stuff, they had left for, I think it was 2 or 3 weeks. And had traveled a long distance away. And they thought that it was a good idea to have 3 college boys live in their home for that 2 or 3 weeks. And so we were out of the dorm and we were living in a home, which was great for us. And 2 weeks went by. And the cafeteria was closed in college. I think it was during the summertime, so it was great for us to have a place to live. And they thought that it was great to have somebody living in their home. And the truth of the matter is that I was not mature enough to have this task, me or the other two guys that were living with me, because essentially we ate Taco Bell and Burger King and McDonald's, and we ate out all the time. And I had a problem with cleaning anything up or throwing anything away. I think once the trash can got full and it was overflowing, we just started putting stuff on the end of the couch over here and started putting, we don't have room there, we'll just throw it on the floor here. And in 3 weeks of three guys eating fast food, and a window got broke somehow, and I don't know, it was not a good thing. And back in those days, there were no cell phones, so I didn't know exactly when they were coming. And then somehow we got word that they had passed Clinton, Missouri, and they were only an hour and a half, 2 hours from coming back. And you should have seen three guys kick it into gear and try to find trash liners and try to find where is the vacuum sweeper? I don't even know, you know. And so we were kicking it into gear and going like that. You see, the truth is if they would have pulled up at an inopportune moment, we were not ready for them to come. It would have been embarrassing. That was like, I don't know how many years ago, 35 years ago, something like that. And I'm still embarrassed to this moment. Matter of fact, I was thinking of the illustration. I go, I don't know if I want to give that, because I don't know if perhaps the person that we were in their home might somehow listen tonight. I don't think they are, but I pray they're not. Because I don't think that they knew that it was not ready. But anyway, there's an embarrassment. There's this guilt feeling. So how do you feel when you're not ready and somebody knocks on the door and you're not ready? How do you feel? You feel panic. In my situation, and maybe if you're not ready for the Lord to come and he knocks on the door and you've got something in your life, there's a little guilt and there's this idea of I want to clean that up and I'm not going to answer the door immediately, if you will. Some have to fix some things up just to be ready. The thing that's great on the other side about being ready is that there's a joy waiting for them to pull up into the driveway. There's a joy in waiting for the trumpet to sound. Let's go, I'm ready. Let's boogie, we're out of here, you know? And there's this excitement. And so I can live my life excited, guilt-free, because I'm ready. So this is what I'm saying. It's a good way to live your life, so that and the way you check this is you just think in your mind, if I heard the trumpet sound right now, is there anything that I have in my life? Is there anything between me and the Savior? Is there anything that I would be embarrassed about? Is there anything on my computer? Is there anything in my conscience? Is there anything in there that I'm not ready? Because, you see, that's how Christ is coming. He's not going to phone ahead. The Bible says in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, the Bible says that a man and a woman are going to be going up a hill, and one's going to disappear and one's going to be standing there. It says two will be in the bed and one will be taken, and it's going to happen in a moment, and you're not going to be ready. So the best thing to do is to be ready tonight, right now, and ask yourself, am I ready for Christ to come? Or are there things that I wish that were not there? I think back on, and I shouldn't think about it, but I think of Ravi Zacharias and the cancer treatments and the short period of time he had from cancer diagnosis to death. I wonder if he thought about what was on his phone or on his computers, and are people going to find that and all that kind of stuff. I wonder if that was just haunting him and realizing that there's no way, I don't have enough time to clean all of that stuff up and that kind of thing. I wonder if there was some shame, inner shame, that we don't even know about. I hope that there was shame. I hope that he was not so, you know, numbed to the thing that he didn't have that. But conversely, to be ready is nothing but excitement. And not only that, I just want to say that if we can focus our life on that, the Bible says that here's a good news, is that it's blessed is the man. So when God knocks on the door, you throw it open and say, I'm ready for you. And God looks at you in your life and you are ready for him. Guess what the Bible says? Blessed is the man that lived his life in such a way that he knew the better way to live, that he's ready. The Bible says, blessed is that man. And join me in verse 37. And this is an illustration of a master that's gone away and is coming back, and then he finds them doing the right thing. He said, blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Oh, they're watching, they're waiting, they're ready. Verily I say unto you that he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to meat and will come forth and serve them. Good things. Verse 38 goes on with the good news. And if he shall come in the second watch or in the third watch, who cares when he comes? I'm ready. And find them so. Blessed are those servants. Verse 40, skip down to verse 40. Be ye therefore ready also. There's a better way to live your life. Here's the way to live your life. Yes, think about heaven, but think about I'm ready for Christ to come. I'm ready for the trumpet to sound. Verse 40, be ye therefore ready also, for the Son of Man cometh at an hour when ye think not. About the time you're thinking he's not going to come, that's when he's coming. You're gonna jump because you go, woo, I thought I was always ready. I'm constantly thinking, oh, the trumpet's gonna sound. No, about the moment you begin to rest, that's the moment it's gonna sound. It's gonna shock you. So he says, be therefore ready. Verse 43, blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Sure, there's all kinds of unhealthy things that you can get snagged up in your life, and you can get off on some rabbit trail someplace, but there's a better way to live your life. Live your life in such a way that you realize that when your master comes, the Savior that you say you love, the Savior that saved your soul, that has heaven waiting for you, live your life in such a way that you're ready to go. And that's a good question to ask yourself every morning, every night, on a regular basis. Search my heart, O God, see if there be any unclean way of me. Seemed to me that David was kind of good at that as well. Is there anything in between? Am I ready? Am I not ready? I want to be ready. And so if you're still not understanding the message, the flip side is verse 45, 46, and 47. And that is those servants that are not ready. And I don't understand necessarily all of the analogies that he gives, but I don't have to look too far into it to realize. Verse 45 says, here's a guy that lives his life in such a way, the master's not coming back for a long time. That's verse 45. My Lord delayeth his coming and shall begin to beat the men servant and maid servant. So he's abusing the people that are around him, eating and drinking and drunken is what verse 45 says. Listen, you know, you're not ready for the master to come back for you. But what happens is the Lord of that servant will come in a day when he looketh not for him, and an hour when he shall not be aware. Good analogy Jesus is bringing to us. And he's going to cut him asunder. And he will appoint him his portion with the unbelievers. Guess what? He's going to lose it all. Verse 47, and that servant which knew his Lord's will and prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. So listen, I hope that you walk out of here and realize Jesus in Luke 12 is giving us an analogy of a better way to live your life. Live your life in such a way that there's nothing between you and the Savior, so that you're ready in case he comes. And by the way, he could come even tonight. And so I suppose we could divide it into two sections tonight. We've talked about there's a better way than worrying about people ripping us off and coveting stuff that we don't have. There's a better way of living your life than worshiping money so that you can eat, drink, and be merry, as if the ultimate goal is to retire and live at ease. There's a better way to live your life than worrying about the needs that you have. How am I going to clothe my kids and pay my mortgage and do all of those things? Take all of that energy that it takes to worry about how your bills are going to be met. Take all of that energy and redirect it toward God. If the bills are going to get paid, you're the one that's going to have to do it. Lord, if I'm going to have a job, you're the one that's going to have to give it because you're my provider. You see, that's the lane I'm going to live my life in. If things are going to happen, it's going to be because you've done it. Listen, if you can get that in your life, if you can understand that, if you can give that, you'll have no problem with pride because he's your provider. And you will live a life of spiritual victory because you'll understand something very important about life and who God wants to be. And you'll put him in the right place. And it'll be a good thing. Not only that, there's a better way to live your life. And that realize that God's ultimate gift is coming. Always encourage yourself with the heaven that he's provided and that he is anticipating with great anticipation, waiting for that moment where he can provide for you that wonderful ultimate gift that he wants to bless you with. And I love that passage where it talks about the fact that he is looking forward to giving us that ultimate gift. And that's found in verse number 32. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. He wants to give it to you. Live in that lane where we're ready for heaven. And then the final one is be ready for God's return as well. So these are good things. And I went a little longer than I wanted to go tonight. I'm sorry about that. But I love Luke 12. I really do. And I think if you meditate a little bit on the words of Jesus, I think there's a lot to learn. And if you think about it in terms of him teaching us about life, I think that we can learn a lot. So thank you for those who are joining us online. We have quite a few join us online sometimes, and so I'm thankful for that. And we'll have a word of prayer, and we'll actually take prayer requests here in just a second, but let's pray and thank God for the message tonight. Father, thank you, Lord, so much for the message from your word. I pray, Lord, that we can implement these things in our life. It's almost counterintuitive. It comes natural to worry about things we don't have. It kind of comes natural for us to worry about how we're going to get these things, but it kind of comes natural for us not to think about a million years from now and think about where we're going to be and take comfort in that in terms of heaven. But help us to do that. Help us to put you in the right place and help us to live these things. And I'll thank you for that. I pray, Lord, that you would bless the prayer request tonight, our missionary to the Amazon. Pray, Father, that you bless the prayers that will follow this meeting. I pray, Lord, that you would bless the prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. God bless you all tonight. All right, ladies, if you want to stay in here, you can. Gentlemen, let's head off and we'll go someplace and we'll go down the hallway a little bit. Let's spend a little bit of time.